Revolution Point Zero by Silvia Federici. Part 1. Theorizing and Politicizing Housework. Chapter 1. Wages Against Housework, 1975. They say it is love. We say it is unwaged work. They call it frigidity. We call it absenteeism. Every miscarriage is a work accident. Homosexuality and heterosexuality are both working conditions, but homosexuality is workers' control of production, not the end of work. More smiles? More money? Nothing will be so powerful in destroying the healing virtues of a smile. Neuroses, suicides, desexualization, occupational diseases of the housewife. Many times the difficulties and ambiguities that women express in discussing wages for housework stem from the fact that they reduce wages for housework to a thing, a lump of money, instead of viewing it as a political perspective. The difference between these two standpoints is enormous. To view wages for housework as a thing rather than a perspective is to detach the end result of our struggle from the struggle itself and to miss its significance in demystifying and subverting the role to which women have been confined in capitalist society. When we view wages for housework in this reductive way, we start asking ourselves, what difference could more money make to our lives? We might even agree that for a lot of women who do not have any choice except for housework and marriage, it would indeed make a lot of difference. But for those of us who seem to have other choices, professional work, an enlightened husband, a communal way of life, gay relations, or a combination of these, it would not make much of a difference. For us, there are supposedly other ways of achieving economic independence, and the last thing we want is to get it by identifying ourselves as housewives, a fate that we all agree is, so to speak, worse than death. The problem with this position is that in our imagination, we usually add a bit of money to the wretched lives we have now and then ask, so what? On the false premise that we could ever get that money without at the same time revolutionizing, in the process of struggling for it, all our family and social relations. But if we take wages for housework as a political perspective, we can see that struggling for it is going to produce a revolution in our lives and in our social power as women. It is also clear that if we think we do not need that money, it is because we have accepted the particular forms of prostitution of body and mind by which we get the money to hide that need. As I will try to show, not only is wages for housework a revolutionary perspective, but it is the only revolutionary perspective from a feminist viewpoint. A labor of love. It is important to recognize that when we speak of housework, we are not speaking of a job like other jobs, but we are speaking of the most pervasive manipulation and the subtlest violence that capitalism has ever perpetrated against any section of the working class. True, under capitalism, every worker is manipulated and exploited, and his or her relation to capital is totally mystified. The wage gives the impression of a fair deal. You work and you get paid, hence you and your boss each get what's owed, while in reality, the wage, rather than paying for the work you do, hides all the unpaid work that goes into profit. But the wage at least recognizes that you are a worker, and you can bargain and struggle around and against the terms and the quantity of that wage, the terms and the quantity of that work. To have a wage means to be part of a social contract, and there is no doubt concerning its meaning. You work, not because you like it or because it comes naturally to you, but because it is the only condition under which you are allowed to live. Exploited as you might be, you are not that work. Today you are a postman, tomorrow a cab driver, All that matters is how much of that work you have to do and how much of that money you can get. The difference with housework lies in the fact that not only has it been imposed on women, but it has been transformed into a natural attribute of our female physique and personality. An internal need, an aspiration, supposedly coming from the depth of our female character. Housework was transformed into a natural attribute rather than being recognized as work because it was destined to be unwaged. Capital had to convince us that it is a natural, unavoidable, and even fulfilling activity to make us accept working without a wage. In turn, the unwaged condition of housework has been the most powerful weapon in reinforcing the common assumption that housework is not work, thus preventing women from struggling against it, except in the privatized kitchen-bedroom quarrel that all society agrees to ridicule, thereby further reducing the protagonist of a struggle. We are seen as nagging bitches, not as workers in struggle. Yet, how natural it is to be a housewife is shown by the fact that it takes at least 20 years of socialization, day-to-day training, performed by an unwaged mother to prepare a woman for this role, to convince her that children and husband are the best that she can expect from life. Even so, it hardly succeeds. No matter how well trained we are, few women do not feel cheated when the bride's day is over and they find themselves in front of a dirty sink. Many of us still have the illusion that we marry for love. A lot of us recognize that we marry for money and security, but it is time to make it clear that while the love or money involved is very little, the work that awaits us is enormous. This is why older women always tell us, enjoy your freedom while you can, buy whatever you want now. But unfortunately, it is almost impossible to enjoy any freedom if, from the earliest days of your life, you are trained to be docile, subservient, dependent, and, most importantly, to sacrifice yourself and even to get pleasure from it. If you don't like it, it is your problem, your failure, your guilt, and your abnormality. We must admit that capital has been very successful in hiding our work. It has created a true masterpiece at the expense of women. By denying housework a wage and transforming it into an act of love, capital has killed many birds with one stone. First of all, it has gotten a hell of a lot of work almost for free, and it has made sure that women, far from struggling against it, would seek that work as the best thing in life. The magic words, "Yes, darling, you are a real woman." At the same time, it has also disciplined the male worker by making his woman dependent on his work and his wage, and trapped him in this discipline by giving him a servant after he himself has done so much serving at the factory or the office. In fact, our role as women is to be the unwaged but happy and most of all loving servants of the working class, i.e., those strata of the proletariat to which capital was forced to grant more social power. In the same way as God created Eve to give pleasure to Adam, so did capital create the housewife to service the male worker physically, emotionally, and sexually, to raise his children, mend his socks, patch up his ego when it is crushed by the work and the social relations, which are relations of loneliness, that capital has reserved for him. It is precisely this peculiar combination of physical, emotional, and sexual services that are involved in the role women must perform for capital that creates the specific character of that servant, which is the housewife, that makes her work so burdensome and at the same time so invisible. It is not an accident, then, if most men start thinking of getting married as soon as they get their first job. This is not only because now they can afford it, but also because having somebody at home who takes care of you is the only condition of not going crazy after a day spent on an assembly line or at a desk. Every woman knows that this is what she should be doing to be a true woman and have a successful marriage. And in this case, too, the poorer the family, the higher the enslavement of the woman, and not simply because of the monetary situation. In fact, capital has a dual policy, one for the middle class and one for the working class family. It is no accident that we find the most unsophisticated machismo in the latter. The more blows the man gets at work, the more his wife must be trained to absorb them, the more he is allowed to recover his ego at her expense. You beat your wife and vent your rage against her when you are frustrated or overtired by your work, or when you are defeated in a struggle, but to work in a factory is already a defeat. The more the man serves and is bossed around, the more he bosses around. A man's home is his castle, and his wife has to learn to wait in silence when he is moody, and to put him back together when he is broken down and swears at the world, to turn around in bed when he says, "I'm too tired tonight," or when he goes so fast at lovemaking that, as one woman put it, he might as well make it with a mayonnaise jar. Women have always found ways of fighting back or getting back at them, but always in an isolated and privatized way. The problem then becomes how to bring this struggle out of the kitchen and the bedroom and into the streets. This fraud that goes under the name of love and marriage affects all of us, even if we are not married. Because once housework is totally naturalized and sexualized, once it becomes a feminine attribute, all of us as women are characterized by it. If it is natural to do certain things, then all women are expected to do them and even like doing them, even those women who, due to their social position, can escape some of that work or most of it because their husbands can afford maids and shrinks and enjoy various forms of relaxation and amusement. We might not serve one man, but we are all in a servant relation with respect to the entire male world. This is why to be called a female is such a put-down, such a degrading thing. "Smile, honey, what's the matter with you?" is something every man feels entitled to ask you, whether he is your husband or the man who takes your ticket on a train or your boss at work. The revolutionary perspective. If we start from this analysis, we can see the revolutionary implications of the demand for wages for housework. It is the demand by which our nature ends and our struggle begins, because just to want wages for housework means to refuse that work as the expression of our nature, and therefore to refuse precisely the female role that capital has invented for us. To ask for wages for housework will by itself undermine the expectations that society has of us, since these expectations, the essence of our socialization, are all functional to our wageless condition in the home. In this sense, it is absurd to compare the struggle of women for wages for housework to the struggle of male workers in the factory for more wages. In struggling for more wages, the waged worker challenges his social role but remains within it. When we struggle for wages for housework, we struggle unambiguously and directly against our social role. In the same way, there is a qualitative difference between the struggles of the waged worker and the struggles of the slave for a wage against that slavery. It should be clear, however, that when we struggle for a wage, we do not struggle to enter capitalist relations because we have never been out of them. We struggle to break capital's plan for women, which is an essential moment of that division of labor and social power within the working class through which capital has been able to maintain its hegemony. Wages for housework, then, is a revolutionary demand, not because by itself it destroys capital, but because it forces capital to restructure social relations in terms more favorable to us and consequently more favorable to the unity of the class. In fact, to demand wages for housework does not mean to say that if we are paid, we will continue to do this work. It means precisely the opposite. To say that we want wages for housework is the first step towards refusing to do it, because the demand for a wage makes our work visible, which is the most indispensable condition to begin to struggle against it, both in its immediate aspect as housework and its more insidious character as femininity. Against any accusation of economism, we should remember that money is capital, i.e., it is the power to command labor. Therefore, to reappropriate that money which is the fruit of our labor, of our mothers and grandmothers' labor, means at the same time to undermine capital's power to extract more labor from us. And we should not distrust the power of the wage to demystify our femininity and making visible our work, our femininity as work, since the lack of a wage has been so powerful in shaping this role and hiding our work. To demand wages for housework is to make it visible that our minds, our bodies, and emotions have all been distorted for a specific function. In a specific function, and then have been thrown back at us as a model to which we should all conform if we want to be accepted as women in this society. To say that we want wages for housework is to expose the fact that housework is already money for capital, that capital has made and makes money out of our cooking, smiling, fucking. At the same time, it shows that we have cooked, smiled, fucked throughout the years, not because it was easier for us than anybody else, but because we did not have any other choice. Our faces have become distorted from so much smiling. Our feelings have got lost from so much loving. Our over-sexualization has left us completely desexualized. Wages for housework is only the beginning, but its message is clear. From now on, they have to pay us because as women, we do not guarantee anything any longer. We want to call work what is work so that eventually we might rediscover what is love and create our sexuality, which we have never known. And from the viewpoint of work, we can ask not only one wage, but many wages, because we have been forced into many jobs at once. We are housemaids, prostitutes, nurses, shrinks. This is the essence of the heroic spouse who is celebrated on Mother's Day. We say, stop celebrating our exploitation, our supposed heroism. From now on, we want money for each moment of it, so that we can refuse some of it and eventually all of it. In this respect, nothing can be more effective than to show that our female virtues have already a calculable money value, until today only for capital, increased in the measure that we were defeated, from now on against capital, for us, in the measure that we organize our power. The struggle for social services. This is the most radical perspective we can adopt because, although we can ask for daycare, equal pay, free laundromats, we will never achieve any real change unless we attacked our female role at its roots. Our struggle for social services, that is, for better working conditions, will always be frustrated if we do not first establish that our work is work. Unless we struggle against the totality of it, we will never achieve any victories with respect to any of its moments. We will fail in the struggle for free laundromats unless we first struggle against the fact that we cannot love except at the price of endless work, which day after day cripples our bodies, our sexuality, our social relations, and unless we first escape the blackmail whereby our need to give and receive affection is turned against us a work duty, is turned against us as a work duty, for which we constantly feel resentful against our husbands, children, and friends, and then guilty for that resentment. Getting a second job does not change that role, as years and years of female work outside the home have demonstrated. The second job not only increases our exploitation, but simply reproduces our role in different forms. Wherever we turn, we can see that the jobs women perform are mere extensions of the housewife's condition in all its implications. Not only do we become nurses, maids, teachers, secretaries, all functions for which we are well trained in the home, but we are in the same bind that hinders our struggles in the home. Isolation, the fact that other people's lives depend on us, and the impossibility to see where our work begins and ends, where our work ends and our desires begin. Is bringing coffee to your boss and chatting with him about his marital problems, secretarial work, or is it a personal favor? Is the fact that we have to worry about our looks on the job a condition of work, or is it the result of female vanity? Until recently, airline stewardesses in the United States were periodically weighed and had to be constantly on a diet, a torture that all women know, for fear of being laid off. As is often said when the needs of the waged labor market require her presence there, a woman can do any job without losing her femininity, which simply means that no matter what you do, you are still a cunt. As for the proposed socialization and collectivization of housework, a couple of examples will be sufficient to draw a line between these alternatives and our perspective. It is one thing to set up a daycare center the way we want it, and then demand that the state pay for it. It is quite another thing to deliver our children to the state, and then ask the state to control them not for 5, but for 15 hours a day. It is one thing to organize communally the way we want to eat, by ourselves, in groups, and then ask the state to pay for it, and it is the opposite thing to ask the state to organize our meals. In one case, we regain some control over our lives, in the others, we extend the state's control over us. The struggle against housework. Some women say, how is wages for housework going to change the attitudes of our husbands towards us? Won't our husbands still expect the same duties as before, and even more than before, once we are paid for them? But these women do not see that men can expect so much from us precisely because we are not paid for our work, because they assume that it is a woman's thing, which does not cost us much effort. Men are able to accept our services and take pleasure in them because they presume that housework is easy for us and that we enjoy it because we do it for their love. They actually expect us to be grateful because by marrying us or living with us, they have given us the opportunity to express ourselves as women, i.e. to serve them. You are lucky you have found a man like me, they say. Only when men see our work as work, our love as work, and most important, our determination to refuse both, will they change their attitude towards us. Only when thousands of women will be in the streets saying that endless cleaning, always being emotionally available, fucking at command for fear of losing our jobs is hard, hated work that wastes our lives, will they be scared and feel undermined as men? But this is the best thing that can happen to them for their own point of view, because by exposing the way capital has kept us divided, capital has disciplined them through us and us through them, each other against each other. We, their crutches, their slaves, their chains, open the process of their liberation. In this sense, wages for housework will be much more educational than trying to prove that we can work as well as them, that we can do the same jobs. We leave this worthwhile effort to the career woman, the woman who escapes from her oppression not through the power of unity and struggle, but through the power of the master, the power to oppress, usually other women. And we don't have to prove that we can break the blue-collar barrier. A lot of us have broken that barrier a long time ago and have discovered that the overalls did not give us any more power than the apron, quite often even less, because now we had to wear both and had even less time and energy to struggle against them. The things we have to prove are our capacity to expose what we are already doing as work, what capital is doing to us, and our power to struggle against it. Unfortunately, many women, particularly single women, are afraid of the perspective of wages for housework because they are afraid of identifying, even for a second, with the housewife. They know that this is the most powerless position in society, and they do not want to realize that they are housewives too. This is precisely our weakness, as our enslavement is maintained and perpetuated through this lack of self-identification. We want and must say that we are all housewives, we are all prostitutes, and we are all gay, because as long as we accept these divisions and think that we are something better, something different than a housewife, we accept the logic of the master. We are all housewives because, no matter where we are, they can always count on more work from us, more fear on our side to put forward our demands, and less insistence that they should be met, since presumably our minds are directed elsewhere to that man in our present or our future who will take care of us. And we also delude ourselves that we can escape housework, but how many of us, in spite of working outside the home, have escaped it? And can we really so easily disregard the idea of living with a man? What if we lose our jobs? What about aging and losing even the minimal amount of power that youth and attractiveness, productivity and female productivity, afford us today? And what about children? Will we ever regret having chosen not to have them, not having even been able to realistically ask that question? And can we afford gay relations? Are we willing to pay the possible price of isolation and exclusion? But can we really afford relations with men? The question is, why are these our only alternatives, and what kind of struggle will take us beyond them?